Well, hey there, everyone. Welcome to North Metro Church, and thanks for spending part of your weekend with us. Before our service gets started, here are three things you need to know, highlighting what's in store here at NMC for you and your family. Our popular equipping classes are starting back up in January. Visit northmetro.org to learn about sharing your faith and emotionally healthy spirituality. Sharing Your Faith is a three-week course that's going to help you live more confidently on mission and sharpen your skills to turn conversations toward God. You'll gain confidence in sharing your own journey with Jesus and walk away with skills, knowledge, and a changed heart. The class Emotionally Healthy Spirituality is all about tending to life below the surface and strengthening your emotional and spiritual health. Come and let's grow stronger and deeper together. Complimentary childcare is available for infants through fourth grade students with required sign-up. Sharing Your Faith starts January 13th, and Emotionally Healthy Spirituality, EHS, starts on January 13th. The childcare deadline for both is Wednesday, January 9th. How would you like to have even greater understanding of God's truths and greater confidence to answer questions that challenge your faith? For example, why do bad things happen to good people? Or how can God be all good and all powerful, yet evil still runs rampant in our world? Is Christianity really that different from Judaism, Islam, Buddhism? Don't all religious faiths basically say the same thing and advocate the same eternal destination? These are just a few of the topics we plan to address in Answering the Tough Ones. This 7-week class begins Sunday, January 13th. We'll meet at 4 p.m., and registration is required for complimentary childcare by Wednesday, January 9th. Come and discover the fun in challenging yourself to think more deeply about your faith. Register your student for their favorite weekend of the year, Walking Wisely. We are bringing students from 8th to 12th grade to Woodlands Camp the weekend of January 25th through the 27th. At this retreat, students will enjoy community, fun recreational activities, times of worship, teaching, and prayer. You're not going to want to miss this. To get your students signed up, visit the events page on northmetro.org or check it out in the NMC app. Well, that's it for this week's three things you need to know. For more on these events and everything else happening at NMC, pick up a copy of this month's newsletter out in the lobbies. And now, begin to prepare your heart for worship. Today's service begins in 1 minute.
I believe that my season will come. This is the season that we get to live in, the season of celebration, the season of celebrating the newborn king that grew to be the resurrected king, right?
Amen. Yeah.
So let's just celebrate. Let's sing to the top of our lungs, give all our heart, soul, mind, and strength to it, and let's sing. Come on.
Sleep.
pray, Father, you're just good. We love you, Lord, and we look to you right now in this season. No matter what season we find ourselves in, whether it's a season of celebration, whether it's a season of just acknowledging how great you've been to us, God, whether it's a season of hardship, God, we just want you to meet us in every season like you do. Our longing for that is exceeded by your longing for that. So, God, I pray that you would just meet us right where we are today, that you would meet us and that you would change us. Help us to see you for who you are and be forever transformed, because I believe in it, and I have seen it in my own life, that when we gaze upon your face, everything changes. We are never the same again. And so, God, I pray that you would just do that according to your riches and glory, according to your good, your favor, and your good pleasure. You are good, and we want to see your goodness today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Make some love for Jesus, guys. Yeah. All right. Hey, welcome, 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 North Metro. Everybody doing well? All right. Well, hey, glad you're here. My name is Daniel. I have the honor of being one of the pastors here, and so glad to be here with you. And say real quick, welcome to those who are watching online. Thanks for syncing up with us. And also say thank you for those who are up in the theater right now, getting to chime in and see what God's doing here at North Metro Church. And if you're a guest here, this is your first time, or you've been here for just a few weeks, just trying to figure out the lay of the land, we want to say welcome home. We say that all the time because we want this place to be home. It's home for us, and we pray it's home for you as well. And speaking of welcome home, if you're trying to figure out what we're doing here, what the mission is, what God has asked us to do in our community and across the world, we actually have a class called Welcome Home that starts up in January, and it's a couple weeks experience for you to come learn all about the DNA and how you can jump in at North Metro Church. And so I want to encourage you, if that's you, hey, go to the website, sign up, go to Connection Center down here at the end of the hallway and sign up. Also, if you're new here, you can take this little offering envelope, a little connections card on your seat. Take that, fill it out at some portion throughout the service. And as you leave today, there's going to be host team members at the door, and they have some baskets. You can just drop that in there as well. And we promise, we say all the time, hey, we're not going to hound you. We're not going to give you spam, all those things. We want to help you connect to a life-giving body of Christ and help you plug in and find a place called home. Because, again, we believe this place is home, and we believe that God is doing something special here. And if you look around, we say this all the time, and I hope it's not lost on you, but around you is a sea of people who are extremely, extremely generous. So North Metro, I just want to say thank you for your continued generosity and being faithful to give and to be a part of what God's doing here in the community and the world around us. And a few weeks ago, we had an incredible privilege to just bless hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of kids in our community through a thing called Hope for Christmas. And you guys gave and brought presents and all these great things to provide hope for Christmas to a bunch of families who just needed some hope. And so I want you to watch this video of what happened in our house just a few weeks ago in this thing called Hope for Christmas. So check out the screens.
Deck the halls with boughs of holly. Ba la 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 la. Tis the season to be jolly. Oh, ba la 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 la. Don we now our gay apparel, fa la 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 la. Troll the ancient Yuletide carol, fa la 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 la. See the blazing you'll be for us, fa la 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 la. Strike the harp and join the chorus. Oh, follow me in merry measure while I tell of Yuletide treasure.
Yeah, yeah, hey, yeah, there you go. Hey, did that look like a lot of fun? It looked like a lot of fun, and that experience happened because the faithfulness of God and the generosity of other people. So thank you so much for being generous. If you have a tithe or offering today and you want to continue to be generous, you can give that to the host team member as you leave as well. Today, we're going to land our series that we've been in called Unto Us. And I don't know what's happening right now. Everybody's sitting down in the back. Like, something happened back there. I don't know what's going on. The front half is kind of at loss. Hey, don't worry, front people. I'm going to make them stand up in just a moment, because here's the deal. We're landing the plane on our series called Unto Us. Rob is going to bring a word today that he was sharing this morning with us, and I'm super excited so you get to hear from our lead pastor. And so as we prepare, all you guys stand in the back, I would have you guys, why don't you stand up? And I want you to high-five five neighbors and say, I'm glad that you are here.
That's a lot of high-fiving going on, people. Well, good morning, everybody. Again, that was kind of lame. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Thank you. Awesome. Great. Well, I'm excited to get into today's message. I've enjoyed the series. I love Christmas. I got a story. How many of you here, raise your hand if you're married? All right. Guys, I apologize in advance, okay? So I heard this story about this guy who proposed to his gal. It's an amazing story. This guy, he asks his gal, says, hey, let's go on a date. She, as far as she knows nothing about it. Picks her up in his car, normal car, and they drive to the lake. It's like, okay, this is cool. And they get into the speedboat. And they get in the speedboat. I don't know if he rented it, he borrowed it, whatever. And they're just racing around, having a blast. It's wonderful, you know, sunny day, beautiful day. Then he parks the boat on this little island where this picnic has been set up for them. And she's like, okay, he's creative. This is interesting. They have a little few appetizers, whatever, something to drink. Get back in the boat, and then they get back to the landing. His car is gone. Now there's a limo there. Now she knows if something's up, right? They get in the limo, and they drive to this airfield where there's now a plane. That they get in the plane, they take off, they fly around the city. They're able to go, oh, look, there's our school. We're going to, you know, there's your house, whatnot. Land the plane. Now the limo's gone. There's this old beat-up truck. They get in the beat-up truck, and they drive to this little chapel. And the chapel has been set up. Like, there's roses all over the place. Now she knows something's up. And, like, there's candles there, whatnot, little small chapel. No one else is around. And there's a sign that says, please walk in. And he's like, you know, she walks in. There's rose petals on the ground. She gets to the end, and there's a card that says, will you marry me? And, of course, he's on a knee. And he asks her, she says yes. And so here's what I know right now. In one sermon illustration, I have ruined the dreams and the hopes of most of the young ladies here in the room. Because, I mean, seriously, where do you even get a plane? You know what I'm saying? Who does this? Who does this? But here's the thing, guys, as you're cringing, going, my story isn't like that at all. This story gets better. So they get back into his car, and they go have dinner. And at dinner, he says, I want to explain what all that was about. Like, it wasn't enough that that was awesome. But now there's meaning behind it. Who does this with the meaning and all? Seriously, can't we just have fun? So he says, so my car is symbolic of just the normalcy of life that you can expect from me. And here's what I promise from you in just the normal days. I'm going to be there for you, and I'm going to pray for you and love you, whatnot. And he goes on, this is what I promise you. And he says, the boat, that represents the fun times we're going to have. And I'm going to promise that I want our life to be fun. And so I want to save for vacations, things like this. And if the Lord is kind and allows us to have children, we'll have fun with them. And these are the things I'm going to promise you. And he says, now the limo, that represents the times in our life when things like crisis and circumstances happen. And actually, we won't be driving. Other people will be coming alongside us and helping us. And in those seasons, here's what I'm going to promise you. I'm going to be a guy who's going to be consistent, going to be there for you in sickness and health, those kind of things. He says, the plane, that represents our spiritual journey. Like, I want it to only ascend, and I'm going to grow. We're going to grow together as we go closer to the Lord. Again, who can get a plane? Anyway. And he says, the old truck, the jalopy, that beat-up truck, that represents our old age. And we're in the twilight years of our lives. This is the things that you can expect from me. This is what I'm going to be. This is the kind of guy I'm going to be. And if God allows me to hold your hand at the end. This is what I'm going to do for you, right? And now, of course, I know, right? Ladies, you're just like, oh. And the guys are going, I missed it. Right? The men in the room, if you're married, you should just apologize to your wife now. I'm sorry. I didn't know. I thought it was like dinner, and that's it. All we had back in my day was dinner. Planes weren't even there. I don't even know. But here's the thing, and I want to say this to the men and the young men in the room, right? For those of you who are single, here's what I need you to fully understand, okay? You got a gal you're going to ask to be your wife one day. When you ask her to marry you, two questions are going to be asked of her like 18 billion times. One is, can I see the ring? And the other one is, how did he propose? And so if you're thinking like, oh, you know, I'm going to put the ring on my toe and then get to a dinner, ask her to give me a foot massage, and be like, oh, what's that? Oh, will you marry me? Listen, she's going to, some people are going to ask her, she's going to have to tell that story over and over. You're going to look like an idiot. So, man, listen. There is Google now. There is YouTube. Use it. Be creative, okay? The stakes are raised. Sorry, they're just raised, but the resources are also more in your favor, so be there. But here's the thing, back to the girl. So all this happens, and a couple of things are happening. Excitement and anticipation, right? I mean, for the moment, yes, she's excited. Oh my goodness, we're getting married, and there's anticipation for the wedding. But here's what's gonna trump all of that. She's not just anticipating the wedding, she's anticipating those promises actually being kept. And you got to think about this. I mean, people are going to ask her. She's going to share that story a billion times. And it's going to be wonderful. But as people watch them in their marriage, and actually he promises, though he actually keeps those promises, that's when people are going to be going, oh, you know what? He said that. He said he was going to do that. He said it was going to happen. I remember when he promised. Do you know his story? Oh, I need to tell the story. Oh, my goodness, it's amazing. And even as they get older, as he keeps keeping these promises, people are going to be saying, oh, I remember the story. The plane. Is it the plane? Yeah, the plane. He's a plane guy. Oh, man, he just prayed for his family. He held her hand through that difficult time. It was amazing. It's awesome. And the story's going to be told and told. Because here's what I know. Promises kept actually become stories shared. Right? The old adage, well, promise made is a promise broken. Right? That's what's normal. But promises kept, we're like, oh, you've got to hear this. That guy, standard guy, amazing, awesome. Promises kept become stories told. But here's the thing, ladies. If you're like with a guy and you're thinking, I think he's the one. If you're going to say yes to him, here's a question you've got to ask yourself. Does he have what it takes to deliver on the promise? Like, what has he shown you thus far? What he's promising you now, does that kind of match up to where he's been and what he's shown you thus far? Does he have what it takes to deliver on the promise? Because that's what you want. We all make those at the ceremony, right? They're called the vows. I promise you in sickness and health and all those kind of things. Yes. But before you get there, you got to ask that question. Does he have what it takes? Because here's what I know about your boy's amazing story with the promise he's making with the jalopy and the plane. He has no idea what life will give him. Right, because we're limited. We can't know. We can hope. You can do your best, but he doesn't know how much jalopy truck time there's going to be versus how much limo time there's going to be. He didn't know how much time there's going to be in just the average car versus, you know, just the limo time, where it's, you know, the circumstances are difficult. And you're talking about the plane. Listen, you know what happens for a plane to get off the air, off the ground. Lift and thrust. It's very violent. Okay. You know what people, when people are in a plane, you know when you're not white knuckling it most of the time? Watch, take off. Because you're just thinking, I just need to get up real high where we feel like we're floating. Because right now it feels like the plane's gonna fall apart, right? That's spiritual ascent, right? And in our own lives, we know, man, life is rocky. It doesn't just do like that, like it goes like this, right? How much turbulence is gonna happen? He has no idea. But here's what I do know, as to contrast your boy's story about his promises that he's making, that we hope, and he hopes, and she hopes, that he can deliver on and tell those stories. Our God has made some unbelievably epic promises, and he has kept every one of them. It's who he is. He has a great track record, and he still keeps those promises. This whole series is about looking back into the Old Testament, specifically looking at the prophet Isaiah, who made so many different prophecies, promises from God to say, this is what you can expect. Today we're going to go into one of my favorite chapters. It's chapter 53 in Isaiah. I want to tell you how you get there. If you got your Bible, because you may not be used to going to Isaiah. Number one, the easiest way. There's a table of contents in the beginning of the Bible, right there. Or here's a quick way to do it. If you see, try to do this. Take your Bible, cut it in half. This time go to your left, cut it in half again, then go to your right. Half, half, half. Boom, Isaiah, what happened? And it's Mark, that was easy. Anyway, so half, go to your left, half, 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 towards your right, okay? You should wind up in Isaiah. If you're in Psalms, you didn't have something. So Psalms, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, Song of Solomon, then you get in Isaiah. If you're in Zechariah, so, I mean Ezekiel, you're going too far. Go back to the left. Anyway, where were we? Yeah, Isaiah 53. In Isaiah 53, here's what's amazing. Here's what's awesome. In this, you actually have a breakdown of Jesus' life. In the first four verses, you have his life, his living. And then 5 through 8, it talks about his death. And then in verse 9, his burial. And then 10 through 12, that's kind of from God's perspective, talks about his resurrection and his exaltation, his glorification. And although we can see this. And so Isaiah, hundreds and hundreds of years before Jesus, he's saying, God wants me to know, wants you to know something. Hope is coming. Hope is coming. And this is God, thus far we've seen, he makes good on his promises. So we're going to jump in, sort of in Isaiah chapter 53, starting off with verse 3. He was despised. Again, this is Isaiah speaking in the past tense, as in God's economy, this is already happening, right? So God is not limited by time. He was despised and rejected by mankind. A man of suffering. The theme of this entire chapter is that an innocent servant died for the guilty. He was despised and rejected by mankind, a man of suffering and familiar with pain, like one from whom people hide their faces and was despised, and we held him in low esteem, right? We didn't think much of Jesus when he was here, or the people on the outside. Surely he took up our pain and bore our suffering. I love this. We'll get back to that later. Yet we considered him punished by God in the midst, right? Even some people have a problem with Jesus now. They're like, why would God do this? If this is your beloved son, why would you allow him to be nailed to a cross? Doesn't sound real to me. Yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. Let me help you understand something. The Jews never crucified. That was a Roman thing. Jews might stone someone, throwing stones at them. But here's Isaiah speaking words that go, who are you talking about? We don't do that, bro. But he was pierced for our transgressions. Transgressions is rebellion against God. He's using this in the form of sin. He was crushed for our iniquities. And we're going to come to that, back to that word, a word none of us ever use ever. The punishment that brought us peace was on him. Do you get this? It's the gospel message that he bore the weight of our sins. He was punished for us, and that brings peace, and it was upon him. And by his wounds, we are healed. Not, I'm a good person, I'm going to be healed. Not, I'm going to do better, I'm going to get a better degree and a better job, then I'll help more people. No, by his wounds alone, we are healed. We all, in the Greek, this is crazy, or in the Hebrew, this all means all. Just to make sure you understand, we all, like sheep, have gone astray. That's everybody. Each of us has turned to our own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. We did it. We did the crime. And he's doing the time. He was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth, and he was led like a lamb to the slaughter. And so many verses. Over eight times in the New Testament, portions of this one chapter are quoted all over the place. Paul also speaks a lot about it. Peter quotes it several times in the gospel. It's quoted. And so, like a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before its shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. Again, just looking to see when Jesus was in front of the high priest, Caiaphas, when he was in front of Pilate, in front of even his accusers, he remained silent. Scripture talks about this. By oppression and judgment he was taken away. Yet who of his generation protested? For he was cut off from the land of the living. for the transgression of my people, he was punished. So by oppression and judgment, he was taken away, yet who of his generation protested? Here's the reality. Part of what that's talking about is the Jews in the area, they had the Messiah. They were praying for the Messiah, but they didn't recognize him because they were thinking, wait a second, this guy, he's the guy who's going to actually take away our sins. This is why the people said, you know what, forget Jesus. Give us Barabbas. Give us the criminal. Crucify him, because they could not even fathom that God was actually making good on his promise. He was assigned a grave with the wicked and with the rich in his death, though he had done no violence, nor was any deceit in his mouth. Again, talking about his death and now God's perspective, the resurrection, the exaltation. Yet it was the Lord's will to crush him and cause him to suffer. Let that sink in. It was his will to crush him and cause him to suffer. It was his absolute beloved. But he did this for us. And though the Lord makes his life an offering for sin, again, they don't even know about Jesus. This is hundreds of years before him. He will see his offspring and prolong his days, those who follow after him, not his physical children. And the will of the Lord will prosper in the land. After he has suffered, he will see the light of life and be satisfied. By his knowledge, my righteous servant will justify many, and he will bear their iniquities. So again, he will justify many. Not everyone is going to simply receive and acknowledge the free gift of Jesus. And he will bear their iniquities. We'll come back to that. Therefore, I will give him a portion among the great, God says, and he will divide the spoils with the strong, because he poured out his life unto death and was numbered with the transgressors, for he bore the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors. Here's one of the things that the Word of God, in my humble opinion, does brilliantly. It does a perfect job of it. It does a perfect job of actually dissecting the human condition. See, for years and years and years, and even currently, philosophers and sociologists and sometimes psychologists are gripped by the question, why is it that we do some of the things we do? Why do we have a certain bent towards certain things? Why do we run into things like addiction or lust or you know, just a number of different things, rage, things like that? Why is this? And they would say, hey, here's the thing, two things. I mean, one thing, here's why. It's your environment. You're shaped by your environment. That's what does it. But actually, here's what God's Word says about this. God's Word says, actually, it's not your environment. Actually, what Scripture says is you were birthed forth from iniquity. What is iniquity? So transgression means rebellion against God, and here he's talking about sin. Iniquity talks about that internal twisted bent that is within every single one of us. Scholars talk about this as original sin, or your sinful nature. It is just within you. And so why is it that we run towards some of these things? Because, hey, it's brokenness is within us. There's a twistedness within us. Each one of us manifests itself in different ways. Does your environment help with that? You better believe it. Like, this thing is within you, and your environment that you find yourself in sometimes throws a log onto the fire to keep things burning. But it didn't start with, now I know right and wrong, I shall choose this way. No, it's just within you. Before you even knew right from wrong, this was within you. And the beautiful thing is, and I need you to catch this, as he says, he was crushed for both of those things. For both of those things. I mean, you think about this. What an exhausting life it would be if God just says, I'm just going to forgive you for your sins. Well, now I'm going to spend the rest of my life continuing to do the same old things, making the same old broken choices, and life is exhausting. Thanks for the forgiveness, but is there end to this? Can I just get better? And he says, yeah. He was also crushed for your iniquities. North Metro, that is beyond good news. That's the best, amazing, most beautiful news ever, ever. It's within us. In Proverbs chapter 14, there's a way that appears to be right, but in the end, it leads to death. The problem is, within us, we think, well, this is the right way. Yeah, because that's because you got a twisted bent within you. Why do we continue to walk into things like addiction and lust and rage and all other things? It's because of what's in you. It's what's in you. And so here's what Isaiah is trying to say. He's saying Jesus takes our transgressions and our iniquities from us. Now, the amazing thing is, and I love hearing this story, sometimes that iniquity is taken immediately, right? Sometimes, for some people's story, and those the amazing story, it's like, I will say with my story, when I became a Christian years ago, one of the things that God healed in me immediately was racism. I mean, immediately. Took it from me. I mean, we hear the stories that are amazing, like this guy, you know, guy says, you know, I was addicted to heroin, I became a Christian, now I don't even long for it anymore. We're like, amen, hallelujah. But it's atypical, right? Usually it's this, when Jesus says, hey, you abide in me and I'll abide in you, those healings are over time. And as we continue to lean into him, he begins to heal that over and over as we pursue the relationship with us. And so here's the great thing, what Isaiah is saying about this coming Messiah that we see in Jesus. He's not just going to treat the symptoms, he's actually going to cure the disease. And that is good, good news. He said, I'm going to change your heart so I can change your life. That is the gospel. It's the beauty of the gospel. As Isaiah is saying, the one who's coming, this is how he will be. And we see this in Jesus. And so Jesus takes our transgressions and our iniquities from us, but what happens? Where's a big gaping hole? No, he replaces them with God's righteousness. And that'll blow your mind. Because here's the thing, God looks at us in our sin, and most of the time we're going, he's looking at us going, you disgust me. No, he never says that. He may say that about your sin, but he never says, you disgust me. And in Christ, this is the mind-blowing thing. In Christ, despite all of my sin that is offensive to his holiness, when he sees me simply because I've trusted in what Jesus has done, he doesn't see me. He sees Christ's perfection. Christ's perfection. And so when I say all the time, if you're in Christ, you are his adopted son or adopted daughter, actually, you need to understand and embrace it, because a lot of people, they just think, yeah, but I'm his son or daughter. That makes him kind of go, ugh, that one. The one that messes up all the time. No. Man, God replaced that and grants us righteousness, his right standing. As Paul would say in 2 Corinthians, God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him and through him and only through him we might become the righteousness of God. Here's what I love also in John chapter 2. I love this, how trying to paint this picture. My dear children, here's what I love about this. You might be in your 60s. You might be in your 50s. And you may be thinking, I'm all that. Don't call me a child. I've got great grandkids, for crying out loud. Just to make sure you understand, Sparky, in the eyes of God, you're a child. And you should revel in that. Because here's the thing, man. Like with my kids, for those of you who have kids, I treat my kids like kids, right? I don't expect my kids to do the taxes. I don't tell my kids, you better get a job so you can pay for the food to get on the table. No, right? With children, there's patience, there's love, there's understanding here. And I love this saying, my dear children, that's how God sees you. He understands you. My dear children, I write this to you so that you will not sin. But if anybody does sin, we have an advocate. An advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. So we did the medical there for a second. Now it's the legal. Like with Christ, with this suffering servant, with this Messiah, you actually have an advocate. And so some of you here need to understand this. That through Christ, you need to understand this, that God doesn't just love you. He actually likes you. Right? Does he like your sin? No, but he likes you. He's for you. He only wants your best. And when you mess up, he's not shocked to go, gah! I hate that child. No, he loves you dearly. He loves you dearly. He says, you have an advocate. And so Jesus stands in your place and says, everything you've done, Jesus says, I paid that. I paid that. I absorbed that. I got that. That one's on me. Put that one on me. Put that on what she did, put it on me. Count it me. And Jesus, and the Father looks at Jesus, the spotless lamb, the sacrificed perfection, and says, yeah, I'm granting them now your righteousness. That is the gospel, North Metro. That's the beauty of the gospel. And I love this in Matthew, in Isaiah. Look, he says in verse 4, surely he took up our pain and bore our suffering. Some of you need to understand that. Some people, their view of God is like this faraway, angry kind of God who doesn't understand, but he does understand. just to watch what he went through as we read the Gospels. But I love the writer of Hebrews. He says, listen, we don't have a high priest who's unable to empathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet he did not sin, but he understands. And here's the thing, man, North Metro, I love Christmas. I love it. I love everything about it. Just yesterday, I wrapped most of the gifts and put them around a tree. I love the lights. I love the songs. I love everything about it. But what I really want to focus in on, what I want to talk about, what I need to be primary in my life, in my mind, in my heart at Christmas, what I want to talk about with my kids and with my wife, is this beautiful gift, the greatest gift that we've ever received. And I want people to know about this, because here's the thing, promises kept become story shared. That if anyone, man, listen, I have yet to meet anyone who's perfect, anyone. And as a pastor, I meet people all the time who have stories of regret. And you know what I get to tell them? Not, oh, you're a sinner. No, I get to say, oh, I want to tell you about Jesus. Man, he will take it from you. He's already paid the price for you. Acknowledge him. Align yourself with him. He's got it. You are loved. You are fearfully and wonderfully made. Do you know that? I need to tell you about it. There's this amazing point. I'm going to close with this story. This whole idea that promises kept becomes story shared. It's all over the gospel, all over the New Testament, of people pointing to tell people about Jesus. There's this moment when Philip, one of the disciples, he's walking along and God says, hey, I need you to go down here and don't ask questions. He's like, okay, I'm walking, I'm running, I'm riding, whatever he's doing. I don't know if he's on a donkey, not really sure. But he's heading that way. And he stumbles upon someone. And he gets to actually help him understand Isaiah chapter 53. And Acts chapter 8. Now an angel of the Lord said to Philip, go south to the road, the desert road, that goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza. Okay. So he started out. Didn't ask questions. Like, okay. All right, he just starts going. So he started out. And on his way, he met an Ethiopian eunuch. So this guy here, eunuch, most scholars say he's just a high official. Again, not Jewish. An important official in charge of all the treasury of the Kandake, which means queen of the Ethiopians. This man had gone to Jerusalem to worship, so he was a God-fearer. He wasn't a Jew, and so God-fearers had to stand outside the temple to even experience what was going on. But something within him was going, there's something about this God that I've heard, and I want to be close to him, and I want to know him. And on his way home, he was sitting in his chariot reading the book of Isaiah, the prophet. The Spirit told Philip, go to that chariot and stay near it. Okay. I don't know, it's my voice for Philip, I don't understand. Tony, whatever, just kind of came out. Might change next service. Then Philip ran up to the chariot and heard the man reading Isaiah the prophet. And Philip's like, hey, bro, do you understand what you're reading? Well, how can I, he says, unless someone explains it to me. So he invited Philip to come up and sit with him. Man. Here's what happens next. Oh, my Paul, we have more next, sorry. This is the passage of scripture the eunuch was reading. He was led like a sheep to the slaughter, and as a lamb before its shearer is silent, so he did not open his mouth. In his humiliation, he was deprived of justice. Who can speak of his descendants, for his life was taken from the earth? The eunuch asked Philip, tell me please, who is the prophet talking about, himself or someone else? Then Philip began with that very passage of scripture and told him the good news about Jesus. He's like, I'll tell you about him. It's going to make your brain explode. It's going to make your heart explode. Here's what you're going to get to fully understand. You don't have to be a God-fearer anymore. You don't have to stand back. You don't even have to wonder, oh, well, could I ever get close to him? Philip goes, "You can, this is amazing. I want to tell you. It's already happened. The promise has already been kept." And Philip shares a story. You know what it says? It says the Ethiopian believes him. And he's like, you got to get baptized. And then the Ethiopian goes, well, dude, there's water right there. Why are we going to wait? And Philip's like, okay. Goes down and baptizes him. And it says that the Ethiopian goes off rejoicing and he returns home. And if you go to Ethiopia, the Ethiopian church, to this day, they point to say, that's where our church got it started. It first got started there. It got to start in that moment with Philip in a chariot with one dude who heard a story about a promise kept, and then that guy came back home and told us about the promise kept. And that story keeps being told over and over and over and over again, and that's why Christmas is celebrated. Christmas is a story being told about a promise being kept, North Metro. And so I've got two invitations. For some of you today, you're like me when I was in college. Maybe you're here today, and if someone asks you, hey, what do you believe? And maybe your answer would be something about, well, if I'm a good person, I'll go to heaven. And if they say, well, where'd you read that? Where'd you get that? Ultimately, you go, well, I heard it, or I just kind of feel it, I think it. And for me, I had to realize someone showed me in the scripture to go, man, that good person getting into heaven thing is nowhere in scripture. As a matter of fact, what it says is we're all like sheep. We've all gone astray. As Paul would say, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Everybody, all, everyone. And so you need a better solution. And Jesus screams into our life to say, I'm it. I'm it. Well, can I just help people? Can I just pay some money? No, you can. That'd be awesome, and you should. But that's not going to help you. And maybe for some of you today, actually, maybe you finally got it today. Maybe today's a day you finally actually got it. And I'm going to give you an opportunity here in a second that if you've never prayed to receive Jesus, to acknowledge him as your Savior, I'm just going to give you an opportunity to do that. And my second invitation is for those who follow Jesus. This is a very spiritual time of the year, not just that it's Christmas. It's also, I've seen it all over the place, that the Holy Spirit does some amazing work within people. Like I get emails and calls, and I tell people, and I hear stories about going, man, I need my questions answered. I feel alone. I don't feel worthy. I don't know what's going to happen when I die. This is a time of year where, for whatever reason, I say the Holy Spirit starts stirring within someone's spirit to move them from death to life. And he says, church, you're not just celebrating Christmas. You're sharing the story of my promises that I keep. And so here's the reality. God in his kindness places you in the environment that he places you with the people around you. And so next week is Christmas Eve and Christmas. We're going to have 6 services. And so if you have not taken the time to cross the street to invite your neighbors, if you've not mentioned something to your coworkers, and you, every day you're like going, I should ask them, but I don't know. Well, there's my, oh, well, now they left already. I'll do it next year. Don't wait. Why would you wait? What if they don't have next Christmas? What if you don't have next Christmas? North Metro, promises kept become stories shared. Let's do this together. Let's share the story that unto us a Savior has been born. That is why we celebrate. Pray with me. Father, I thank you for your kindness and your goodness. I thank you for your great love for us. I thank you, Lord, that so many years before Jesus, that you spoke through this prophet these promises that you would show that you always keep your promises, that the hope that you promised would come in full force in the person of Jesus. Not just forgiving of us of our sins, but also giving us the power, healing our iniquities, that twisted bit within us. And over time, Lord, and sometimes immediately, Lord, because of this relationship, you say, I'm going to take it away. I'm going to replace it. I'm going to replace it. And then ultimately, you will only be longing after me and my righteousness, that your heart will beat and break for what mine beats and breaks for. And so God, we celebrate that. We thank you, Lord, that you're a God who keeps your promises, and we'll keep sharing that story over and over and over and over again. And Lord, we just ask, Lord, in humility with great zeal and excitement, would you let more people in our life that we could simply share the story, not about what we've done, but what you have done. And so Father, right now, I want to speak to those people that they're here and they know right now, they've been kind of twisting in their seat a little bit. Maybe some people are getting a little emotional because they know you're doing something. It's different than in the past. So they know they're not just sitting here yet again, but something's happened. They just got it. You helped them see it, Lord. As Paul says, scales, something like that, fell off my eyes, and I now see. I once was blind, but now I see. And so if I'm talking to you, if you've never ever prayed to ask Jesus to be the Lord and leader of your life, with our eyes closed and our heads bowed, just repeat in your heart and your mind something like this: that God, I admit I'm a sinner. I'm imperfect, and my sin needs to be atoned for, accounted for, and I can't do it. I can't just do enough good works. It's not the way it happens. And so I believe, Jesus, that you are who you say you are. I acknowledge you, that you are Lord and Savior of my life. I confess, Lord, that that is who you are, that I am in deep need for you. You are Savior and you are Lord. And because of that, you now will look at me and see Jesus, my past, present, and future sins, and with me, this relationship with me, because you give me the gift of the Holy Spirit, that over time and sometimes immediately, these things that have been wrecking my life, you will take away, that you promise, lean into you, and you heal it. With our eyes still closed and our heads still bowed, out of respect for one another, here's what I want to say. If you prayed that prayer for the first time, we just want to give you a gift. And our team here has these bags, and these bags are just, it's a Bible and a devotional and just kind of a brochure from us to say, hey, here's how we can help you. This is a ball we want to place in your court. We will not stalk you. But if you prayed that prayer for the first time, people do this every single week in this church, will you just raise your hand so we just place that in your hand? Just raise them high right now. Just let the people see. If you're in the auditorium and you're in the theater, if you'll just raise your hands, we'll get those to you. Father, I know the courage that it takes just to move your hand from your hip to over your head, and hundreds of us in this place have done it. And right now, Lord, I'm asking you to remind all of us of that time when we did it, when we had to brave through the moment to discover your love, and also a community of people who love one another, knowing none of us is perfect, and we lock arms with one another saying, you bet, we're with you. I thank you for the courage. I thank you for just the joy that heaven is celebrating, Lord. It's an honor and a privilege to be part of that story. Father, I pray, Lord, that when we see the people in our lives that you placed there this week, that we would also take the courage to point them to you, that we would invite them to Christmas Eve. Just say, come sit with me. And if the door opens, Lord, that we can share that amazing kept promise. Lord, we need you. We need your guidance, we need your love, but Lord, we just want to celebrate you and thank you and be grateful that you did it all and you gave it to us. It's in Jesus' name, amen. We're going to have a moment, a tangible moment where we get to remember his goodness. We have communion, and this is this moment where we look back and remember when Jesus was disciples and where he broke the bread at this Passover and he began to put a new color, new paint on this canvas, and say, this is my body broken for you. Take and eat. And he raised the cup and said, this is my blood. This is shed for the forgiveness of your sins. Take and drink. And he says, do this in remembrance of me. And so as a church, what we do is we take the bread and we dip it in the juice in that moment. And we taste and we remember how good God is and how kind he was to save a sinner like me. It's an act of worship. It's an act of remembrance. And so here in a moment, upstairs and down, our host team are going to release you by rows, and the band's going to be singing some songs. And so for those of you who are followers of Jesus, this is a tangible moment just to remember his goodness.
Over.
Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns his face away as wounds which mar the chosen one. Bring me, his sons, to glory. Christ, the risen one, we today. It's done. Yeah.
Amen. Amen. North Metro, you've had a good morning? Yeah. Yeah. Rob said this line that really marked me, and I hope it's a gift for you this morning. He says that God not just loves you, he likes you. And I hope you received that. Maybe you came in this morning and you don't know what God thinks about you. And I want you to know that God not just love you, because he does love you. The cross is the objective evidence of his love for you, but God likes you as well. And if you need to help process that, if you need somebody to pray with you, you want to talk about anything you've heard this morning, I want to remind you there's a prayer team down front. So as people are heading out this morning, you can make your way down the front. We'd love to connect with you, pray with you, and help you any way that we can. And speaking of help, you guys know it's Christmas like in a few days. Is that like weird to anybody? Like it's just right around the corner, right? And so next weekend we're celebrating Christmas. And here's two things I want to just put before you if you're available. We need some help, some table setters. That's what we call our volunteers here, our table setters, specifically next Sunday and Monday at the 5 o'clock services. So if you're available to help out, we need some specific help in kids ministry and in guest services. I want to encourage you, if you have some capacity, I want to encourage you to take a step and go to the North Metro page and sign up, or go to Connection Center and sign up so we can really roll out the red carpet for people to come and to be loved on and to hear the message that God not just loves them, but likes them. And speaking of Christmas, we got some Christmas CDs on sale. This is some music from our worship team, and they're actually on sale in the nooks out there. I want to encourage you to get it, because here's what I know. Today is actually my 1 year anniversary of being on staff at North Metro. And when I, I said that to prep this next thing. And the next thing I was told, I want to say is that I was told when I got here, the first thing, hey, learn the culture of North Metro. Learn the people of North Metro. And here's what I learned about North Metro people. You don't consider it Christmas until you've heard Little Drummer Boy by Matt Solin. Yeah, yeah. And you haven't heard it yet. And you're like, it's not Christmas yet. Where is Christmas? It's on a CD that we sell out in the nook. So go get you some Little Drummer Boy and consider it Christmas, all right? Hey, and speaking of Christmas, it's the season, as Rob talked about, God has kept his promise. And his promise kept is a story that is worth sharing. And God has placed you where you are, when you are, to love people around you, to make a difference, to make an impact. So I encourage you, go out, share the love of Christ. Let them know that God is a God that keeps his promises. He came to love us and to like us and to rescue us, because there's no plan B. He's placed us here to make a difference, to join him and partner with him in this story of rescue and redemption. So North Metro, maybe go out these doors. Maybe go to work. Maybe you go to your neighborhood. Maybe go everywhere we go. Let's go out and share the love of Christ, because found people, love you guys. You're dismissed. Thank you.
Close by me forever and love me, I pray. Bless all the dear children in thy tender care, and take us to heaven to live with thee.
How much fun it's gonna be together. This Christmas, the fireside is blazing bright. We're caroling through the night. And this Christmas will be a very special Christmas for me. Presents and cards are here. My world is filled with cheer and you. This Christmas, and as I look around, your eyes outshine the town they do. This Christmas, the fireside is blazing bright. We're caroling.